Welcome to the Foreign Policy Week in Review with Daniel McAdams. Thanks for joining me again, Daniel.
Hi, Jay. Good to be back with you.
Always good to talk to you. Last week we were talking about the agreement in Iran having to do with nuclear energy and nuclear weaponry, I guess. And we were hopeful, or at least I think I read you right when you were positive about the agreement, in the sense you wished that we didn't need to be involved with any of these agreements, but nonetheless it looked like something fairly positive, and still does to me, honestly, from what I know about it. But obviously, as you predicted last week, there are going to be a lot of people kicking back and raising heck about it, and probably distorting the story and lying about what the agreement really was entailing. And sure enough, article on Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity website, Senator Tom Cotton, he says, essentially, he's saying, let's bomb Iran. It'll be a breeze. It'll be a cakewalk. It'll be very easy. We can just take these guys out and straighten them out, and we don't need any agreement. We'll just force our way on them. What's this all about, Mister? What's this Senator Tom Cotton? Who is he, and where is he coming from, and what is he all about, and what's this article about?
Well, he's sort of the new breed of neocons. He's a young fellow. Unlike most neocons, he's a perfect neocon. I mean, he's perfect for them because he actually has served in the military, and he served in Iraq, I think, which is very unusual for a neocon. Usually the guys that have served, they often come back and say how horrible it was, but he apparently liked what he saw. And he is, as you know, the author of this letter that Congress sent to their Iranian counterparts, which was extremely condescending, saying, well, perhaps you don't understand our system, but let us tell you that if you guys think you have a deal, just wait until the next president and we're gonna rescind it, you know, which is really sort of undermining their own government in a
Sure,
way. And
sure.
so he was behind this, and so he's back with another series of very unusual comments. And this time I as I put in the article, I found it interesting that he was on so-called Christian-oriented Family Research Council radio program. And it's so funny because it's, in my opinion at least, this whole idea that you're for the family, you're for all of this wonderful Christian family thing. And then he went on this radio program and said, we basically, it's not a big deal. We can really start bombing Iran from the air. There's no need to think this will be complicated. And then I thought, this is how the neocons deal with the Iraq War of 2003, which is a disaster that they are the authors of for the most part. And that is to simply ignore it. It just didn't happen. And that's how they are with all of their mistakes. And so he says, we don't have to do the 2003 war. Let's go back to the Clinton era, where he simply bombed them from the air. That'll be a lot easier. He bombed Iraq from the air. Let's just do the Clinton air bombing of Iraq, but just do it in Iran. There's no reason to think it'll be a problem. And if you think about how horrific that is, because what he's essentially calling for is the mass murder of how many thousands or more of innocent civilians in Iran for a weapons program that the CIA doesn't believe exists, the Mossad doesn't believe exists, and there's no evidence that it exists. So what kind of a monster would say something like this?
Well, and to call themselves a Family Research Council, a Christian group, they are supposed to be all about families. I guess they don't care too much about the Iranian families then.
No,
They're going to be
Persian
taking
families
out
don't count.
killing wives and children and destroying families, destroying countries, and every infrastructure is the least of it. But Christians are supposed to be for love and peace, I thought.
Yeah, I think this just shows the twisted mind behind the neoconservative impulse. You know, it's
Or maybe it's part of the propaganda too, to paint to this sort of what, because really underneath it all, Daniel, I can't help but believe that all of this that's going on is all about economics. But you have to have the people to support a war. You have to give them a higher calling or a higher cause. And I suppose this Christian anti-Muslim thing is part of what fuels this.
But you know what? I don't know if Cotton is cognizant of this reality. But interestingly enough, and you know the controversy over Cotton is that Bill Kristol's Emergency Committee for Israel gave him $1 million for his campaign. So you know he's apparently very close to Netanyahu, and he's obviously doing the hard right's bidding, Israeli hard right's bidding. But I wonder if he realizes that in Iran, which he's calling to be bombed, is the largest Jewish population outside of Israel itself in the Middle East, you know? So he's probably going to, he'll probably end up killing quite a few of those if he gets his way as well. So I wonder if he's, really thought this thing through.
Well, as you point out in your article, he just outright lies about the agreement too, doesn't he?
Certainly. He absolutely lies about the agreement. He says that Iran has given up nothing and the U.S. has given up everything. And as we discussed last week, Jay, that's simply factually incorrect. Whatever you think about the agreement, whether you think it's good or bad or we should have it or shouldn't have it, it's an irrefutable fact that Iran has agreed to give up 97% of its uranium reserves. It's agreed to not enrich to the level of medical isotopes, which is significant. It's vastly reducing its number of centrifuges. That's all significant. As I pointed out last week, I'm not a big fan of this agreement because I don't think it's any business of ours what Iran does with its nuclear power. However, objectively, he's not telling the truth, and no one is going to bother to go and read the agreement and try to figure this stuff out. They'll just listen to him and nod their heads.
Right. Well, that's the sad part about it. Is that lies and propaganda can be, you know, can be used to sway the American public and really make us stupid, make us dumb, not allow us to understand what's going on. Clearly, peace is not the desire of the neocons. They have other ulterior, they have other motives for sure. There's no question in my mind about that. I mean, if it might be as simple as just making a lot of money by bombing and building weapons and all that, or it might be, I think it's bigger than that. I think it has to do with geopolitics and control of markets and control of markets essentially and domination of countries.
And I think there is a certain personality type that has a kind of authoritarian personality or a, you know, the neocons follow Straussians. They follow Leo Strauss and who believe that the intellectuals and the elites of a society should preserve their rule through the use of a noble, quote, noble lie.
Right.
You know, you have to deceive the population because the population is too stupid. So I
think
there's a type of personality that is attracted to that idea that we are the elites and we'll tell the rest of you what to do.
Right.
And so I think there's something there as well.
I have no doubt about that. Moving on to another topic, another article on your website. Guess who's loving Saudi bombs in Yemen? Well, as it turns out, Al-Qaeda seems to be benefiting as much as anybody. Wasn't it Al-Qaeda, Daniel, lest I forget? Back in 9/11, wasn't it Al-Qaeda that supposedly drove airplanes into our buildings and killed over 2,000 Americans in American soil?
But that's been a long time ago, Jay.
So it doesn't matter anymore.
No, they're not the real bad guys anymore.
They're not the current enemies. They're nice guys now.
Well, at least if the U.S. has not changed its view on them, then it's certainly its behavior in places like Yemen and Syria would leave you scratching your head as to why they're doing things that benefit Al-Qaeda. You know, the U.S. got behind the Saudi bombing of Yemen from the get-go. They provided intelligence. They've set up joint command centers with the Saudis to reinstall this the President Hadi, who himself took power in a coup and then was, quote, elected with 99% of the vote on a single candidate ballot. So this is the great Democrat they're trying to put back in. But the reason why the U.S. and Saudis like him is that he's a puppet. He does what he's told.
Right.
He let the U.S. drone his country for almost 5 years now. And, of course, that's what produced this uprising in the first place because the population was tired of being droned.
Sure.
As anyone would tend to be in these circumstances. So, but the Saudi attack on the Houthis, these are this tribe that's taken over a good part of the country. The Saudi attacks on the Houthis are really attacks on the strongest enemies of Al-Qaeda in Yemen. The Houthis have been engaged in fighting the Al-Qaeda for a long time. And as a matter of fact, the article that you mentioned that I put up on the site or that I wrote for the site points out that one of the top emirs, he calls himself, from Al-Qaeda was sprung from the slammer by his Al-Qaeda colleagues in the chaos in Yemen. And there's even a great photo of him sitting there with a goofy grin on his face in the governor's palace.
Wow.
With a telephone. It looked like he's ordering a pizza or something.
Wow. From prison to the governor's palace. Not bad.
Yeah, and this is Al Qaeda. These are the people were supposed to be enemies. So.
Yeah, these are the reasons that even your boss voted to go to war in Iraq to try to find the perpetrators, the Al Qaeda.
Oh, you mean Afghanistan? Yeah.
I mean in Afghanistan. Sorry.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Even Ron Paul voted for that, and justifiably perhaps, and going after the individual supposedly or the organization that was involved with attacking us. I mean, if there is an excuse for killing other human beings, I guess the Augustinian concept of a just war.
Yes.
That's about as close as we've gotten to that use of military power in recent times, but in any event.
Yes, exactly. So Yemen is absolutely a mess now, and really the latest news is that the Saudis have been bombing from the air, and it's great business for the U.S. military industrial complex. They're going to spend probably a couple more billion dollars, so that's lots of wonderful beltway jobs that will produce. Mm-hmm. So it's good for Washington in that respect. However, 2 weeks of bombing have only destroyed the infrastructure of Yemen, killed a lot of innocent people, a lot of kids, a lot of families have been killed, but they have achieved no strategic objective because they don't really have one except putting the guy back in power. So they've achieved nothing, and they were counting really on being able to have a ground offensive. But, the Saudis are not known for prowess on the battlefield. So they were essentially hoping that Pakistan would provide the cannon fodder for this ground invasion.
Ah.
But Pakistan voted just recently, I think it was today or yesterday, they voted to stay neutral in this conflict, which has enormous implications for the entire operation. And it really leaves the Saudis holding the short stick. But as I put up a piece today by a great Indian analyst, what that means is the Saudis are going to turn to their Uncle Sam for help. So that's what's coming next.
Oh, you mean troops from America?
Well,
boots on the ground in Yemen from America?
Who knows? It's a slippery slope. The U.S. has already agreed this past week to expedite the shipment of weapons to Saudi Arabia to be used on the Yemenis. So, you're in for a penny, in for a pound on these things.
Yeah. I suppose presumably the Family Research Council is behind this one too, probably. And so what if you destroy a bunch of families and
you've got to crack a few eggs,
You got to crack a few eggs, right? It's just horrible. It's horrible. Another topic. This has to do more now with the Ukraine. Moving back, we haven't talked that much about the Ukraine recently, but in the fight for propaganda to control the hearts and minds of people, of course. What do they say? The first casualty of war is the truth.
Exactly.
And so we have this young lady, a Ukrainian citizen, an artist, a musician, very popular, and she was going to appear in Canada, I guess in Toronto probably, I think, is where she was going to be appearing. But apparently her political views and her outrage about the overthrow, the coup d'etat of an elected government in Ukraine, when she started voicing her views, apparently the Canadians decided to shut her mouth, right?
Exactly, and it's a really interesting tale, and it tells what happens when some little person in a nook and cranny of the empire feels that he has particular power. This woman, Valentina Lisitsa, is a well-known pianist. She's enormously popular on the online. She's very savvy at using social networks, but she's also a recording artist. She's done Rachmaninoff Concerto. She's done Liszt. She has a contract on Decca Records. So she's the real deal. And there's a link to her playing on one of these videos, and it's brilliant stuff. So she's very well known. She had an invitation to play with the Toronto Symphony Orchestra, and all of a sudden they found out. She's, as you say, she's Ukrainian-born, but she lives in the U.S. now.
Uh-huh.
And she did not like – not only did she not like the coup in Ukraine, but she's particularly irritated about the glorification of what are essentially, Nazi-type people that are involved in it. And she specifically, she pointed to one of her successes, the magazine Elle, the French magazine Elle, was profiling some exciting young female fighter on the side of Kiev. And this pianist points out several other photos of her doing the Heil Hitler salute with SS uniform on. So the girl obviously has a repellent ideology, and so she points it out. Why is L glorifying these types of people?
Right, right.
So this fellow Jeff Melanson is the president of the Toronto Symphony Orchestra, and talk about here's a weaselly, typically weaselly way of getting out of it. He says, as one of Canada's most important cultural institutions, our priority must remain on being a stage for the world's great works of music, and not for opinions that some believe to be deeply offensive.
Hmm.
So here's the thing, Jay, that's really amazing. They basically offered to pay her everything she would have gotten for the concert if she would just shut up about being paid off.
Yeah, but you she know, didn't.
She didn't, and she went public with it.
Good.
And it's been a huge outcry, and it really is given a huge black eye, not only to this gentleman, not only to the orchestra, but to the whole to the whole cultural life in Canada. There have been several venues after this that have canceled her as well. So yeah. God bless her. Yeah, absolutely. It's just amazing.
You know, I mean, that she's willing to speak out at a cost to her. We need to have more people willing to do that. And people of renown that will be paid attention to, obviously. Yeah, they get more attention, which is exactly why they wanted to shut her up.
And I can see if it is a private organization, obviously they have the right to hire whoever they want to play. I'm not trying to suggest that they don't have the right to choose.
Sure.
But to somehow pretend that this is something different than what it is, which is the politicization.
Yeah.
You know, if she were to say, I want to go up there and give a speech as well
exactly.
as play, then that's different.
Yeah, you know? Exactly right. If during the concert time she took part of her time on stage to start giving her political views, then you could understand.
Absolutely, yeah.
But essentially, they're taking an aggressive role to try to shut up a person who has a position that they don't agree with or don't want to hear.
It's a preemptive strike.
More importantly, don't want others to hear.
Yeah, exactly.
Again, the first casualty of war is truth. So
absolutely.
It's always the way it is. And finally, though, to try to end today's discussion on a somewhat positive note, you had written an article a couple of days back, Representatives McGovern and Jones, to force the White House or to force a House vote on war in Iraq and Syria. What's this about?
Yeah, that was actually written by my colleague Adam Dick, and it's Walter Jones, representative from North Carolina, is on the board of the Ron Paul Institute. So we've known Representative Jones for a number of years, and he's one of my very favorites that are left in the House. But he's a terrific guy, and he and Jim McGovern, who's been a very solid anti-war voice on the progressive left, and I've worked with his staff for a number of years, and very, very good people. What they've done, they're using sort of a parliamentary technique to force a vote on what the president has been doing since August in Iraq and Syria, which is essentially waging war. He's been dropping bombs, which is war.
Yeah.
So there's a way of introducing a type of resolution. It's called a privileged resolution. And through some sort of a parliamentary technique, you can force a vote on the floor, whereas normally you'd have to go through the process and you would have to be subject to the approval of the leadership, which you'd never have an agreement from the leadership because Speaker Boehner does not want to have a vote on this.
Yeah.
But it's a vote on an up or down vote on this war is not necessarily an end all. Those of us who are against the war wouldn't care if Congress voted for it. It would still be an evil war.
Sure.
Doesn't make it any better if they approve it. But they're making the point that at least the president needs to go through the proper process and Congress has to exercise its oversight authority if the president is going to take us to war, which is essentially what he's doing.
Yeah. Well, it's so when do you expect that vote will come out?
Well, the Representatives McGovern and Jones are going to introduce it this coming week. The House is going to be back in session after the Easter break.
Uh-huh.
And so I'm assuming it'll be fairly early in the week that they will introduce this. And if memory serves, I think the majority party has something like 48 or 72 hours to bring it to the floor, something of that nature. It's been a while since I've looked at these things. But
yeah.
But so I would guess there'd be some action this coming week on it. Very interesting.
But do you think the press will give it any coverage?
I think they will because I think, this is the downside of asking for a vote because sometimes you get what you ask for And I think if it does come to a vote, I think the House will overwhelmingly approve it. So the downside to that is it'll be given a fig leaf of legitimacy.
Yeah.
Whereas we still think it's an absolutely illegitimate, right, counterproductive, dangerous war for the U.S. So that's right, the downside, I think.
Well, what do you think we should be keeping our eyes on going forward next week, Daniel? What do you think is likely to come up to be, you know, the big news next week geopolitically?
I think that Yemen is really the thing to watch. I think the Iranians are getting more and more nervous about the bellicosity of the Saudis. The Iranians the Saudis are probably counting on this. The Iranians are in a bit of a bind because they can't. First of all, it's not in their nature to lash out, despite what people like Tom Cotton say. Iran has not invaded another country since the 1700s, and it's not one to project its power outside of its borders. However, they are feeling threatened by what Saudi Arabia is doing. The Russians have also been very active in calling for a UN Security Council action to halt the bombings and to bring the parties to the negotiating table. I think that is that's a critical issue, and I think we may well see something happening in Ukraine in the next few weeks. There have been reports that the government from Kiev has been moving some of its heavy weapons back into the demilitarized zone. Of course, you won't read that in the media here in the U.S., but
no,
it was in an OSCE report.
No.
So it's not just Putin's propaganda saying this.
Yeah. Well, it's of course, again, it's just the way it is. The casualty of war is the lack of truth.
Yes.
Lies. So, okay, Daniel, well, we'll certainly a lot to keep our eyes on for sure. I have to wonder, you know, it just seems so complicated to me, all of these movements that are going on. First, you have Obama supposedly trying to get some sort of a peace arrangement with the Iranians, the neocons totally aggressively going to fight him tooth and nail to try to keep anything from happening and those along those lines. And I know last week you said one of the things that's likely to could very well hold up this agreement is that the Iranians are expecting sanctions to be lifted immediately. And of course, the U.S. is suggesting nothing like that can happen. Has to occur over time. So it's almost as if it's just posturing or politically posturing, even on Obama's part, perhaps, not really serious about it.
Well, what's interesting though on that, just briefly on the sanctions bit, it will be a real challenge for the U.S. because the U.S. is trying to say that the sanctions will be lifted incrementally, but the agreement, to me at least, looks fairly clear that all the sanctions will be lifted. What could happen is that because there are three levels of sanctions: U.S. sanctions, EU sanctions, and UN Security Council sanctions. So what could happen is the U.S. will drag its heels and say, well, forget it, we're gonna spread this out over a few years. But the EU and the UN sanctions could be lifted immediately over the objections of the U.S.
Uh-huh.
What that's going to mean is, first of all, it's going to show the U.S. as a non-rational actor or as a not a good bargainer. But it's also going to hurt U.S. business enormously because all of these other firms from these other countries are going to be racing into Iran to start doing business there. So maybe the U.S. business community will finally wake up and tell these neocons to sit down and shut up.
Yeah. Again, it would be just, if that happens that way, Daniel, it would be just another indication that Europe is getting sick and tired of being told what to do by the Americans, essentially.
Let's hope so.
Yeah. Yeah, we can hope that. All right. Well, thank you very much, Daniel. Always good to get an update on what's going on in the world and looking at it from the viewpoint of the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity, which, by the way, folks listening to this might want to contribute to the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity. Go to the website, and it's very easy to do. Daniel and Dr. Paul run this organization on a shoestring budget, and so even if you send a small amount, it will certainly be meaningful. So thanks again, Daniel, for being with us, and look forward to do it again next week.
Thank you so much, Jay.